오케이, we'll 사실 벌써 뭐 질문이 굉장히 많은 질문들이 이렇게 들어왔어요. 그래서 뭐 제가 조금 질문을 준비한 걸 갖고 이렇게 좀 써야 될 필요도 없을 것 같고, 많은 분들이 벌써 좋은 질문을 해주셔서 그것부터 좀 시작을 하도록 하겠습니다. 네, 먼저 이 질문이 저는 좀 재미있다고 생각을 했는데요. 실리콘밸리의 시간 개념에 대해서 알고 싶습니다. 그리고 뭐그 하버드의 새벽 4시, 삼성의 새벽 자율출근제 등도 있는데, 뭐 이런 것들이 있는데요. Okay, the question is, it's about your guys' concept of time, how working hours and things like that, how you guys actually working, you know, over the time. So I know that the Troy, when you're working, I know that the you're coming to the working in the Evernote, and you get in the office around 7 a.m. and leaving the office probably about 3 p.m. things like that. So I'm kind of wondering that the how you guys actually working, managing time and kind of collaborate, with your colleagues and things like that. So, and in Korea, Samsung. Okay, so how's that different from the how Korean people working in here?
Yeah, it's a great question. we're very lucky now. Because a few short years ago, we didn't have the technology to allow us to connect with the people we're working with, regardless of where we're at. Let me give you a yay, an example. Last night, I had shicha, so I woke up at 3 a.m. So I immediately connected on my laptop, and I was talking with someone I work with on my team, Margarita, and we were talking about doing a compensation adjustment, adjusting someone's salary in Berlin. The person works out of our Berlin office, right? So here I am at 3 a.m. in the morning in Seoul, Korea, talking with someone in Silicon Valley about someone in Berlin. I mean, we are so lucky to have the technology today. So the companies I've worked at have been very flexible and have really used that technology to our advantage. Evernote was like that. I used to get in at 6 a.m. and then I would leave at 3, but then I would do calls at my home office with Asia from 8 to midnight, right? So, and because I work international, I have many different time zones I have to work in, so technology works. My bosses have always been very supportive. As long as I get things done, they don't care where I am or what time it is, we're always connected. So that has worked well. But it's a cultural change. I know here, the hard part about Korea is you have to sit, we call it butts in seats. Here's your ondongi, right? Like your butt has to be in a seat until your taepyeonim leaves. In fact, I was just at a Korean company yesterday, or I was talking with someone at a Korean company, and he was talking to me about that. Oh, my taepyeonim leaves at midnight. So they don't work until midnight. They waste time until midnight, and then they leave. It's not productive time. So it's just a different way of working.
But that's saying that you're constantly working, some working around the clock. Is that okay with you?
But
And
that's
don't you
right.
feel pressured?
No, that's right. And look at, I could tell you're right. Like you're working all the time,
Yeah,
right?
no, it's
How you're managing your times and because you're working around the clock.
Yeah,
With
I can only imagine you,
Yeah, same thing. We have people all over the world, and so same as you. I had jet lag. I woke up this morning at 2 a.m. and until 7 a.m. I was answering emails and doing work. But at 500 startups, that's something that we are very sensitive to. We're very fortunate that one of our founding partners is a female, Christine Tsai. She's also Korean. But she, again, helps instill a sense of balance in our organization, which is really tough in the startup world, right? So most founders naturally are going to spend as much time as they can trying to develop their product, trying to develop their company. And we admire them and, give them the accolades for doing that. It's a lot of really hard work and a lot of pressure. But we at the firm understand that that can take a toll on a person, right? I mean, if I try to do that now, I would die. Like, I'm not a young man anymore, and I can't do that. And so even, you know, in our place, we take advantage, like Troy said, we take advantage of the technology. If you need to go home early, and if it's more comfortable for you to be working from home, absolutely do it. Spend time with your family. But I think it is really important for the founders to really figure out what are the values of your particular company. I know a lot of founders where it's like they're old school. They'll say, I want you working all the time, as much as you can, nights, weekends, whatever. We need to make this grow as fast as we can. Fine, if that works and you have a team that really values that, fine. But there's other companies where they value, hey, we want to make sure our employees are happy. We want to create a good culture. So let's maybe be more aware of our electronic leashes, right? And let ourselves run free sometimes and not be so occupied about responding within the next 20 minutes, 30 minutes, right? And so it's definitely a debt balancing act in Silicon Valley, and it's hard to, and I think it's probably the same universally. It's just hard to prioritize what's important for you in your lives. But I think for us as a firm, we're trying to make a very concerted effort to make it very, very clear that we think it is important that people take care of themselves, because the last thing we want is our founders to die, right? I mean, we've had a lot of founders go through a lot of pressure and really a lot of stress, and you know, some really bad things can happen.
네, 노 대표께도 똑같은 질문 사실 드리고 싶은데 약간 여기 있는 것처럼 실리콘밸리는 왠지 그렇게 개발을 하고 이런데 데드라인을 해서 푸시하지 않고 자율성을 줄 것 같다라는 또 이런 뉘앙스도 있는데 거기에 대해서 어떻게 생각하시는지 하고 사실 또 하나 질문 드리고 싶은 거는 그 지금 아기들도 많잖아요. 예, 아기들도 많고 쿠퍼티노에 살면서 샌프란시스코로 지금 출퇴근을 하고 있고 또 이 부인도 같이 스타트업에서 샌프란시스코 스타트업에서 일하면서 애들도 사실 키우고 그런 것들이 어떻게 가능한지 좀 너무 사적인
별로,
것까지
별로 이렇게 여기 계신 분들이 살고 싶지 않은 삶을 살고 있는 것처럼 묘사가 됐는데 결국에는 저희가 서울에도 오피스가 있고 샌프란시스코에서도 오피스가 있어서 이론적으로는 저희 회사는 24시간 돌아가는 거거든요. 근데 그것 때문에 더 힘든 거가 분명히 있습니다. 왜냐하면 말씀하신 골이 보통 큰 회사에서 세울 수 있을 만한 골을 세워서 달린다면 사실 그거는 스타트업으로서의 본질을 벗어난 것 같고 그만큼 더 빨리 움직여서 풀어야 될 문제를 빨리 풀어야 되는 거는 당연하기 때문에 그 골은 좀 타이트하게 세우는 거는 맞는 거고요. 그렇기 때문에 사실 그게 강하게 공유가 되고 또 그게 어느 정도 가시적으로 보이면 얼만큼 자리에 앉아 있고 어디에서 일하는 것 자체는 그렇게 크게 중요하지 않은 것 같고 그래서 사실 저희 회사는 결혼하고 자녀분들이 있는 그 사람들이 많아요. 그렇기 때문에 6시, 7시에는 떠나야 집에 가서 같이 밥을 먹거든요. 그러면 이제 같이 밥을 먹고 저녁에 다시 이제 온라인으로 들어와서 일을 하는 경향이 많이 있죠. 특히 샌프란시스코는. 그래서 골을 어떻게 세우고 그게 어떻게 공유가 돼서 그게 눈으로 보이고 사람들이 그 골을 향해서 달려간다면은 사실 뭐 그렇게 크게 시간은 자체에 대해서는 개념이 어떤 구조적으로 세워져 있는 건 아니라고 생각됩니다.
네, 결국은 뭐 시간은 훨씬 뭐 스타트업 그 실리콘밸리가 어떻게 보면 더 열심히 일하고 막 그러는데 다만 장소에 구애받지 않고 그 테크놀로지 IT 도구를 이용해서 어디서든 좀 일하는 그런 문화라고 좀 정리하면 될 것 같습니다. 이번 트로이한테 질문을 드리면은 위블리는 어떤 회사인가요? 라고. And I also want to ask you one more question. And you used to working for the Evernote, actually one of the most well-known, you know, company in the world and startups, and one of the most well-known kind of unicorn startup. But their struggles and still around. But I just want to know that what kind of lessons, your experience you learn that everybody admire your company and all of a sudden really, really struggle and things like that.
Yeah, great question. So Weebly is a company that allows people, anyone, to build a website for yourself. So just like you would build a Word document, you can drag images in and text and things like that. It allows anyone to build a website or an online store so that you can sell things online. And much like Evernote, it's a SaaS model, software as a service. So people sign up for free, create a website, and then to get additional features, 기능들, they will pay money to us for that. It was founded about 10 years ago by three people out of college. They quit college at Pennsylvania State, Penn State, in the US, and they moved to San Francisco to start Weebly. And they grew the company. And it was interesting what you said, Paul, in your presentation. I believe it was you that was saying that one of the things that can be a danger is to grow profitably, like too early, right? And Weebly has tried to balance growing profitably and cash flow positive with market expansion. And they are a company that hasn't gone full bore on marketing and really investing a lot in marketing like some of the competitors. But at the same time, it's a very stable, healthy company. So it's kind of an interesting mix of those two approaches. And I've been very impressed with the founders. The three people who founded it are very good. Then we go to Evernote. I love Evernote. Who loves Evernote in here? I know there's people in here that love Evernote. Korea loves Evernote, right? Yes. Evernote is more than just an app. Like, Evernote is a way of life, right? Like, Evernote, if you're in the Evernote tribe or the Evernote group, you know who you are, right? And you belong to something. Evernote is that way for me. I have some of my team, the Evernote Korea team, up in the back. That came and we had dinner last night. We will be connected for life. My experience at Evernote was a very deep experience of culture and relationships. And I am very happy that I will have those for the rest of my life. But to answer your question, in my mind, what happened with Evernote was a valuation issue. Okay, so Evernote is a great tool. People love it. Hundreds of millions of people are using it. But it was valued really, really highly, very early. And that's good and bad. It happened to Dropbox. It happened to a lot of companies, these unicorns, that got valued very highly. They're still very good companies. Evernote is a great company. They just made it cash flow positive. You know, I mean, it's still fundamentally a very good company, but the valuation was so high that they couldn't grow fast enough to meet the valuation. I see Paul's like, you've seen, yeah, like that's a phenomenon that's happened in Silicon Valley over the past, like, I don't know how many years, 5-6 years of the rise of the unicorns. And it created a lot of great companies, but it put them in an undesirable situation with financing. So you do need to be very careful about how you finance and grow your startup.
So Paul, what do you think that, you know, so as Troy said, Silicon Valley is now kind of overhyped now, the kind of situation?
Yeah, again,
it's going to be a kind of cooling down a little bit?
Yeah, it's definitely cooling down, but you know, again, we invest at the earlier stages, so we're a little bit less susceptible to a lot of those market valuations at the later stages. But yes, absolutely, for those companies that are really successful, they are being punished for their success, right? And that's something that we tell our founders all the time. It's like, when you're fundraising, yeah, it may feel really good to get amazing valuations at your financing levels or, you know, when you're doing your financing rounds. But you gotta think down the line, like, what does that really mean? You're setting yourself up for some really high expectations. Can you meet those expectations? Will this financing round get you to your next round evaluation or whatever, right? And so, yeah, certainly in the Valley, things have calmed down or cooled off for quite a while. But again, I think there's still a lot of money out there that's being investing. And I think, frankly, the investors are taking advantage of kind of the situation. And, you know, they're happy that people believe that there's falling valuations because they're getting in at much better prices. So it's kind of one of those self-fulfilling prophecies, I guess.
오케이. 노 대표님, 그러면 그 여태까지 많은 그런 한국의 스타트업이나 이런 그 창업자들이 실리콘밸리에 도전한다고 이렇게 많이 가고 그랬잖아요. 그런 것들 뭐 많이 이렇게 좀 보시고 조언도 해주시고 그랬을 텐데, 뭐 다른 두 분한테 똑같이 질문 드리려고 하는데, 그 보셨을 때 어떤 것이 부족하고 뭐 어떤 걸 좀 잘해야 될까, 그런 조언 같은 것을 좀 간단히 이렇게 해준다면, 예, 많은 그런 한국인 창업자들이 미국에 가서 이렇게 도전을 하는 데 있어서 하는 그런 그 똑같은 실수라든지 뭐 이런 게 있다면 어떤 게 있을까요? 항상 해주는 말이라든지. 예.
되게 이제 원칙적인 말이처럼 들릴 수도 있는데, 그 결국에는 시장하고 그 거기서 풀려고 하는 문제가 실리콘밸리로 꼭 와야 되는 건지가 첫 번째 질문이 돼야 되지 않을까라는 생각은 들어요. 그래서 실리콘밸리라는 곳이, 저희는 사실 실리콘밸리에서 살다 보니까 거기서 시작을 한 거지, 아 실리콘밸리 도전해야겠다 이렇게 생각을 처음에 창업을 할 때는 하지 않았었거든요. 그래서 도전하는 거는 다 좋은데 왜 도전해야 되는지, 그리고 우리 회사가 만약에 한국에서 시작했었으면 그 한국에서 시작해서 그 한국 시장에서 해야 될 일을 충분히 하고 있는데 실리콘밸리에도 그 똑같은 문제가 있어서, 아니면 글로벌에도 똑같은 문제가 있어서 그대로 실리콘밸리 가면은 그대로 할 수 있다, 열심히만 하고 좋은 인재들이 모이면 하면은 가는 거는 좋다고 생각하고요. 그 다음에 이제 실리콘밸리에 갔을 때 과연 어떤 인재들을 모을 수 있느냐가 제일 중요한 것 같아요. 그래서 파운더들이 실리콘밸리에 가서 과연 얼만큼 좋은 인재들을, 거기에 현지의 인재들을, 그 미션에 완벽하게 바인이 된 인재들을 모아서 더 이상 실리콘밸리에 가서, 한국 회사가 실리콘밸리에 가서 있는 한국 회사가 아닌 실리콘밸리에서 있는 회사가, 실리콘밸리 회사가 돼야죠. 그러려면 정말 경쟁을 통해서 좋은 인재들을 데려올 수 있어야 되고, 그리고 그 인재들이 그 회사에서 있으면서 다른 인재들을 또 데리고 올 수 있어야 되고, 이거를 할 수 있을 때가 되면 그만큼 또 성장할 수 있는 기반이 생기는 거라고 생각이 됩니다.
Paul, do you have anything in your mind? And have you seen any many you know Korean entrepreneurs who's challenging into the Silicon Valley and have met those startups? And do you have any kind of you know advice for them? Kind of general advice?
Yeah, I mean, I think general advice for all entrepreneurs, but especially international Korean ones coming to Silicon Valley. You know, is to try to connect and reach out to the network that's already there. I think Silicon Valley is very fortunate in that there's a lot of Korean entrepreneurs and a lot of Korean VCs and just people that really want to support the community. And so really reaching out to those organizations, I think, is really helpful. But another thing is, again, I think just trying to become familiar with the American culture, which is what Troy touched on a little bit, right? So learning how to be a little bit more aggressive and promote yourself a little bit. And also, you know, just try to figure out how to get yourself in front of the right people. I think that's something that just culturally is a little bit challenging. People maybe language-wise aren't comfortable speaking to investors. But again, you know, I can speak for us at 500. We're accustomed to founders being from all sorts of places around the world in Silicon Valley. So you shouldn't let your language be a handicap or a significant handicap. Mm-hmm. But certainly it does help when you're talking to other VCs if you can speak the language and understand and can interact and sell yourself the right way.
Troy?
Yeah, this is something I've been talking about for a while. When I was at Evernote, I talked a lot about this. Whenever you're exploring a new market, sometimes it's comfortable to stick with, like I see a lot of Koreans that'll come to Silicon Valley, and they'll only meet with Koreans in Silicon Valley. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that I've done in my career, because I'm all about international, if I go to India, I make sure I only, and this sounds weird, but I totally believe this, like, I only eat Indian food. When you come to America, like, when I come here to Korea, I make it a point, I actually try to eat at a gisa shikdang every time. Like, 도착하자마자 gisa shikdang으로 가는 길이에요. Why? Because that is where the Korean market is. I don't learn a lot about the customer by talking with Im Jung-uk-nim. I love Im Jung-uk-nim. But if I only talk with someone like him or investors and stuff like that, I'm not learning about the market. When I rolled the Chiachol for like a long time last night, what was I doing? I was looking at what people are doing on their devices. She's playing a game. The guy next to me was learning law through a video console on it. Like, those are the kind of things that you want to learn. And whenever people come to Silicon Valley from anywhere else in the world, I always make sure to tell them that Silicon Valley is a bubble. It is not America, right? Like, if you go 50, let's see, you know what I'm talking about. You go 50 miles outside of Silicon Valley, and you know this because you live there, America is a big, diverse place. And if you think you're going to learn the America market by going to Silicon Valley, that's probably the worst place to go, actually. It's a good start, but you need to go to Montana. You need to go to Pennsylvania. You need to go to these places. Like, I go to Gangwon-do Wonju and understand what's out there. Sokcho, right? Like, I went to Pohang a little while ago. Like, you need to understand the true market, not the market that is investors and other entrepreneurs, because that's not going to teach you really all about the market. So I would suggest eat local. So the equivalent of a gisa shikdang in America, I would say, is like Five Guys, burgers and fries, or In-N-Out, right? Like, it's funny, like Californians have, it's a total like low-end shikdang, but Californians have a special like thing for it, right? Like, it's just kind of like, it's part of the culture. And so try as much as you can to partake of the culture. Don't just go eat Korean in Silicon Valley, eat American or Indian, wherever you are.
트로이를 작년에 만났었는데 어디서 아침에 만날까 그랬더니 설렁탕 집에서 만나자 그러더라고요. 그래서
맞아요.
설렁탕 먹었는데 정말 이상한 기분이었어요. 아, 지금 문제가 너무 많은 이런 질문을 해주셔가지고요. 제가 이거 이야기를 하면서 지금 고를 수가 없습니다. 그래서 그 다음 질문으로 트로이한테 이 영 스튜던트에 대한 그런 그 어드바이스라든지 이걸 좀 하려고 그러고요. 일단 먼저 예, 그 노범준 대표한테도 굉장히 많은 이런 좀 질문이 왔는데 뭐 이런 것도 있고요. 어웨어는 매출 규모가 어느 정도 되나요? 뭐 이런 실물. 아니, 제가 몇 개를 보여드릴게요. 하드웨어 스타트업에서의 장기전을 준비한다는 것은 어떤 걸 의미하나요? 하드웨어 창업이 꿈인 대학생입니다. 뭐 기술적인 부분이 뭐 어떻게 하면 이렇게 되나요? 뭐 그런 것들. 그리고 뭐 투자 자금을 어떻게 마련했느냐. 그리고 그 뭐지? 대학에서 그런 제조업을 하는 게 이렇게 쉽지 않은데 대학에서 그런 스킬을 좀 배우셨냐든지 뭐 이런 그런 것들이 굉장히 많이 있고 뭐 심지어는 채용 계획이 있다면 어떤 사람을 찾느냐 뭐 이런 것들도 있는데 아까 말씀하셨잖아요. 하드웨어 스타트업을 하는 건 굉장히 어려운 일이고 특히 한국에서 하는 거에 대해서 조금 조언을 해주고 싶다든지 조금 그런 말씀을 하셨는데 조금 빨리 그런 걸 종합해서 좀 말씀을 하신다면 어떤 게 있을까요?
네, 가장 중요한 거가 제 생각에는 한국에서 지금 제조 생태계가 하드웨어 창업들에게 맞춰서 사용할 수 있을 만한 제조 생태가 아직 안 만들어져 있는 것 같아요. 사실 중국, 대만만 해도 거기에 있는 제조 CM들, 컨트랙트 매니팩처들이 그 제조를 서비스화 시켜가지고 많이 제공을 하고 있지만 우리나라는 그런 인프라스트럭처가 있음에도 불구하고 실제 공장에 가서 놀고 있는 그 제조의 파워가 있음에도 불구하고 그게 서비스화 안 되는 부분들이 있죠. 그래서 이거는 어떤 한 기관만이 할 수 있는 건 아닌 것 같고 정부부터 시작해서 저희 창업자들이 한 팀이 돼서 이 우리나라 제조 생태계가 단지 저희 같은 한국에도 있고 미국에도 있는 창업들이 아닌 미국에 있는 사실 저희가 텍사스에 있을 때까지만 있을 때도 일례로 저희만 그 프로토타입을 실제 만들어서 팔 수 있었어요. 근데 그 이유는 저희가 한국 팀이 있었기 때문인데, 그러다 보니까 이제 같이 있었던 배치에 있던 팀들이 아 우리 한국에서 지금 이 일을 하고 싶다라고, 한국에 있는 제조 회사들이랑 같이 일하고 싶다, 팍스칸하고 뭐 PCH 말고 그런 게 있기 때문에 우리나라의 제조 생태계가 글로벌화되고 그게 과연 전 세계에 있는 스타트업들, 하드웨어 스타트업들한테 무슨 의미가 될지 이거를 진지하게 한번 다시 돌아볼 수 있는 기회가 됐으면 좋겠습니다.
네. 폴한테도 뭐 질문들이 이렇게 좀 들어와 있는데 질문들이 너무 많아서.
질문들이 많아요. 그렇게
네,
많아요?
질문들이 엄청나게 많아요. 지금 빨리 고를 수가 얘기해야 없어요. 돼? 네. 한국의 장점이 기업가 정신. You said the strengths of the Korean is a kind of entrepreneurship, and is kind of wondering the what kind of entrepreneurship is. Because we usually think that the Korean people's entrepreneurship kind of not the entrepreneur compared to the you know, people in the Silicon Valley. Also, I also have a question. You said the Korean government is aggressive and very supportive and things like that. And also, so many Korean people don't think that way. So, so what's the desirable role of the government, you know, in Silicon Valley and things like that? I was kind of curious.
Sure. So I think on the Korean entrepreneurship, maybe I'm tainted by kind of my own personal family kind of upbringing, but because again, my parents, they immigrated to the US in the mid 70s, early 70s, and you know, similar to a lot of questions that we're getting here, no one would hire them. So they ultimately started their own business. And if you look in Korea, the immigrant community, there's a lot of people that started their own companies, right? And when I walk around Korea and Seoul here, there's a lot of small mom and pop shops, right? And so to me, that is entrepreneurialism, right? It may not be a company that's gonna go IPO someday, but that is a company that mom and dad is the boss and they make enough money to support their family and to send their children to somewhere better, right? So I think that fire resides not just in Koreans, in people generally, but I think in Korean culture for sure that is certainly there. And you know, I think that's something that it's certainly a positive and a strength from my perspective. In terms of your other question or in terms of the government involvement, you know, we get approached by the Korean government often saying, hey, how can we work with 500 startups for 500 startups to come out and invest into companies in Korea, right? So when we started our Kimchi Fund, you know, we talked to a lot of different organizations. We've got some government entities that are investors in the fund as well, so we can use their money to invest in companies. So at least from my perspective, it feels like the government is trying to do the right things. That being said, the way that we are investing, I think a lot of governments don't really understand the early stage, right? They don't really
because you're also dealing with so many other countries.
Exactly,
you know,
right. Yeah,
they're
exactly.
Not that much kind of, you know,
right,
aggressive
exactly.
And
so,
supportive.
Yeah, we get a lot of governments that approach us saying, hey, you know, we need to diversify our economy, right? We can't just rely on natural resources or whatever it is. So they look at what their most natural resource is, and it's their people, right? It's really easy to cultivate a smart group of people, educate them, and give them the opportunity to, like, create something for the greater good of the economy. Now again, I think in Korea, the challenge isn't so much the government, I would say. It feels like there's just a cultural reluctance to branch off and start your own startup and, you know, take a chance. Again, this is my perception of it, and I know generationally speaking, I think that's changing very quickly, right? There's a lot of younger people and maybe even older people that are tired of working at the same, you know, company for 20 years and they want to do something new. So I think, you know, the gospel of Silicon Valley has spread into Korea, and I think governments around the world, including Korea, are seeing kind of that opportunity. We're like, why can't we take advantage of the people that we have?
And so as a CFO of the 500 startup, how often do you dealing with the US government?
US government? Not so much. We probably not the big Washington, D.C., but we actually interact with a lot of smaller cities. Like, for example, they may not want me to talk
about it. Do you also have a lot of regulation issues?
Well, I don't think it's regulation. I think it's priorities, right? I think a lot of governments in the U.S. don't really have the money to invest into something like that. And so there's certainly a lot of programs out there. Again, I think a recent example is like the city of Sacramento approached us. So Sacramento is very close to San Francisco and to Silicon Valley, but it's nowhere near as cool, right? It's not a cool place. Uh-huh. No one is starting startups.
There's a lot of cows.
Yeah, a lot of cows and.
Soko gimana.
Yeah. So the government approached us. They want to invest with 500 and they want to be a part of 500 because they want us to bring that entrepreneurialism to that region, which is less than an hour away from San Francisco. And that's something that those governments that are okay. thinking forward, that are thinking about how to expand their economies, they're trying to make yeah. those types of moves and they're reaching out to
yeah,
us.
Yeah, one more interesting questions. And what happens after, you know, Trump administration's coming up? So
it's very interesting, right? I mean, again, for 500 startups, like we feel like we're more than just a normal investor. We want to invest in socially meaningful things. We believe in diversity. We believe in investing in non-Americans, right? Like we invest all over the world, right? Uh-huh. And so certainly the infamous policies that Trump is known for, like, you know, being tight on immigration and America first, it's in stark contradiction to what 500 wants to accomplish. Like we believe that we're better off if we're all connected as opposed to isolating ourselves. But again, that being said, I think there's things about the Trump administration that maybe may help out the economy for the U.S. It's too early to tell right now. But certainly if you look at recent stock market performance, it seems like at least Wall Street feels very excited about the opportunities for companies. But again, I think, you know, there's a lot of, you know, thoughts within the venture community around, like, you know, is the government going to be able to invest into the VCs or people or benefit those that are investing in early stage companies? Mm-hmm. So, yeah, we'll see.
Okay. So, Troy, are there any influences after Trump begins his administrations?
I mean, the one that I've noticed most directly is we have talent from all over the world at Weebly, at Evernote. Name any company in Silicon Valley and you will have a mix of a lot of different people from a lot of different countries. So we've had people that are worried about their visa. Will I be able to stay and work at Weebly? Is Weebly a big enough company to have influence to keep me here? Those kind of questions are going on in our employees' minds. And of course, we want our employees to be comfortable and feel like they're safe and can work and do what we hired them to do and not worry about immigration and stuff like that. So that's probably the biggest influence that I'd say that we've seen, and I'm sure that many other companies in Silicon Valley are seeing the same thing.
Mm-hmm. 뭐 이런 질문도 있어서 공기질을 측정하는 것만으로는 좀 어웨어가 한계가 있지 않느냐라는 건데 이런 질문 많이 받으시죠?
네. 네, 많이 받죠. 처음에 사실 저 질문 제일 많이 받았죠. 그래서 측정하는 거가 아까 말씀드렸듯이 공기라는 것은 환기하고 가습하고 제습하고 청정을 하면은 잘 관리를 할 수 있는 건데 저희는 특히 이제 아시아 지역은 미세먼지가 너무 강한 영향력을 미치다 보니까 이제 공기하면 청정기를 많이 생각을 하죠. 근데 이 아토피라든지 집중력이라든지 숙면이라든지 천식이라든지 이런 거는 미세먼지만 없앤다고 다 가능한 게 아니고 실제 공기에 있는 어떤 이물질들이나 상태가 있는지를 파악을 해서 그거를 개인들이 제 딸 같은 경우는 아토피가 너무 심한데 그 제 딸에 맞는 환경을 어떻게 무슨 솔루션을 주느냐까지 가는 게 중요하죠. 그래서 솔루션까지 가는 거는 당연히 중요하고 측정만 해서는 안 되는 거고요. 저희 회사가 측정만 하는 거는 아니고 환기를 어떻게 하는지 빌딩에서 어떤 환기를 하는지까지 고민을 하는 회사니까 공기 측정만 하는 거를 한계가 있고 저희는 이제 솔루션까지 가는 회사고요. 이제 어떻게 보면은 그런 질문을 처음에 할 때 많은 창업자들이 고민을 하는데 그래도 우리가 이 제품만 가지고 보여줄 수 있는 거가 끝이 아니고 그 뒤에 있는 제품이 뭐가 있다라는 거를 생각을 하면 그런 주위에서 아 그것만 해도 돼? 그것만 해도 되겠어? 안 될 것 같은데? 이런 것들이 크게 들리진 않을 것 같아요.
아까 그 잠깐 질문하고 싶었던 건데요. 그럼 하드웨어 스타트업을 하는 데 있어서 투자자를 구하기가 굉장히 어렵잖아요.
네,
하드웨어 스타트업한테 맞는 투자자는 어떤 투자자인가요?
마지막에 있던 슬라이드에 이제 장기전을 이해하는 투자자인 것 같아요. 그래서 사실 초기라고 하면
하드웨어에 투자를 해봤던 사람이 좀 맞지 않을까 싶기도 한데
꼭 그렇진 않더라도 일단 그 철학 자체가 장기전의 의미가 그 어큘러스라든지 네스트라 아니 그 뭐 비츠라든지 이런 고프로라든지 회사가 어느 정도의 터널 끝에 빛을 보기까지는 약 10년이 걸렸거든요. 근데 그게 장기전일 수도 있고 5년이 장기전일 수도 있는 거고 소프트웨어 회사들이 막 빨리 성장하는 회사들도 있으니까. 근데 그 장기전의 의미가 사람들마다 다르겠지만 그 장기전에 대한 어느 정도의 철학을 가지고 있는 그래서 그 성장 과정을 같이 이 여정처럼 같이 갈 수 있는 투자들이면 좋고 사실 처음에 2010년 초에 뛰어들었던 투자들이 그 다음에 약간 뒤였다고 생각하고 빠진 투자자들이 있는데 하드웨어에서 그런 투자자들이 이제 우리 컬처는 그거에 안 맞구나 그러면 이제 하드웨어 투자 안 해야지 그러면 빨리 인식하고 안 하는 게 좋은 것 같고 대신에 이게 장기전이라는 걸 이해하고 그 회사가 어떻게 무슨 일을 앞으로 어떻게 할 거다라는 거에 대한 그 믿음만 있으면 그거에 투자하는 투자자들을 최대한 처음에 초기에 같이 잡는 게 중요한 것 같습니다. 네.
So Paul and Troy, it will be our last questions. And as you know that the Korean economy is in really bad shape and Korean, especially young students, they are really struggling to get a job. And they really have hard time and not a kind of, you know, good foreseeable futures. And so many people actually here too, they're trying to find very stable job to become, you know, public servant or entering a kind of, you know, big companies like the Samsung or LG. And from your perspective, and can you give them or can you, good advice for them and any way, good ways to join very, bright startups and, you know, how to find good startups and things like that? So.
Yeah, I'll take a first crack at that. I think Paul's right. Well, probably, I think you're a little ambitious with your 80% fail. I think it's more like 85-90%, if not 95% fail, right? So we all know that startups will fail. I've been involved with a few startups that have failed. I've learned a ton, and those were great experiences. Work is changing, guys. I hate to tell you, but you're not going to get a job and keep it Pyeongsang. You're not. Like, maybe one or two of you in the room, and that's going to be a very shim-shim-han existence, but if you're expecting now, and I say this in America, in Germany, in Korea, if you're expecting to get that stable job and have it for the rest of your life, like, it doesn't exist anymore. It's gone, right? So accept that and figure out how to compete in today's world. And that's why I always tell people that if I was a young student again, and I think I've actually never found a job. Like, one of my goals in life, like someday, is to actually purposefully find a job. I've never done that. I've been lucky and or done the things in my life that have led me to opportunities. So I think you can study really hard and put that on your resume, but you're exactly the same. That when I was interviewing for someone to head up our Korea operations at Evernote, I interviewed so many people. And I started, amongst my team, I started calling it the robots. Everyone was the same. 우리 민족이잖아요, right? But that's not good, right? You need to be different in some way. And I ended up hiring a younger person who I knew had ambition and intellect, smart. She was smart. And I said, I would rather hire her and train her and coach her, which I did, and she became my star, right? So if you're a young student or you're young in your career, think about how you can make yourself attractive. Like, I think, like, Eunhee. Like, I think about you, like, you know I'm one of your biggest fans. Like, I think she's a rock star, right? And I knew that before she was kind of a VC and everything, when you were doing EUM.
Altos의 박혜연.
Yeah, yeah. But I met her, she's obviously still very young, but I met her when she was even younger. But I could tell that she had that difference, that something special, because she was not a robot. She was different, and she was smart, and she did things. One of the things that I want to emphasize, you go to school, you get your resume, but you've still never done anything. Think about that. Companies want people that can do things. So get your schooling. I'm not saying quit school. I'm saying get your schooling, but find a hobby, find a passion that you can do, and that will help lead you to an opportunity. That's so important today. We're going through this. That's the reason Trump is in America, and in Europe, a lot of this is happening as well, is because jobs are changing and everyone's freaking scared, right? Like, in America, they just did a autonomous vehicle, so they drove a big truck all the way across the U.S. with no driver. The driver was inside, like, reading a book, right? That's going to be, that a lot of people will lose their jobs, but as long as you are creative and you do things, you will be able to find a job. It can't just be your education.
Yeah, so I'm going to speak on behalf of those of us that are not creative and don't have a lot of passions, right? So I'm a finance guy, right? I'm a finance guy. I'm so boring. Like, I'm so boring. My life is so boring. My career, I started off as a CPA, auditor, you know, just, you know, worked through, you know, just worked a lot, and worked really, really hard. And I had, again, the good fortune of being raised in Silicon Valley, so I got exposed to a lot of these great companies. And so when I hear stuff like that, like, oh, you know, follow your passions or whatever, it doesn't compute because I'm not passionate about accounting. I'm not passionate about finance. But what I was passionate about was being part of a company where everyone else was passionate, right? Like, oh my gosh, look at all these passions. People love what they're doing, and that uplifted me, right? But to what Troy was saying, I think it is really important to find whatever it is that interests you, right? I mean, find something. There's got to be something that you're interested in. And find a way to stand out when you're talking about finding employers. And I talked about this in my deck a little bit, but I think this notion of, you know, joining a company and being there for the rest of your life, like Troy said, that's no longer realistic, right? Don't be afraid to take a really awful job. Like, take a bad job. Like, take a job that nobody's heard of, no company's heard of, it's a low position, low pay, whatever, just get some experience, learn something from it. So when you go to your interview a year later, you get to tell the stories of, wow, that was such an awful job, and look at how I made it so much better, right? That makes you so much more attractive. So again, if you have the opportunity to take a really bad job in lieu of not having a job at all, I would say take it. You have to start somewhere. And if you put in that work, and if you, you know, do a really awful job, you'll realize, I don't want to do this. I'm going to go this direction, and you might find that passion eventually.
Can I say one last thing? Sorry, because you just inspired me to tell a quick story. So there was a lady young in her career. She had a master's in marketing, and she wanted to work in marketing in Silicon Valley. She was from Colombia. She has an accent, and she was a little worried about her accent. She took a customer success role. You talk a lot about customer success. She took a customer success role at Evernote. And she was hoping that she would be able to transition into marketing. So she took the job that she didn't want, but then she, 6 months later, was promoted into the marketing team and did a phenomenal job. And I just hired her at Weebly about almost a year ago now. You met her. Maybe you didn't meet her.
Yeah,
but I hired her at Weebly, and now she is just on the track.
Korean girl?
No, she Colombia.
Colombia. I met her. Yeah.
From Colombia. So that's what I'm talking about. Like, get into a job. Like, you're exactly
just
right.
Start working. Just get some
get experience. The experience. Show you have a heart. You're not a robot. And people will notice. Because that's not common, right? Finding people like that is difficult.
저 30초만 마지막으로.
네. 지금 트로이가 밥 먹고 갈 시간이 없어요. 그게 문제입니다.
이제 그 제가 요즘에 그 제 시간의 한 30%에서 40%는 하이어링 하는 데 쓰는데 제가 꼭 해드리고 싶은 말은 만약에 을 아니면 병정이 있다면 그 병정까지의 그 포지션에서 일을 할 수 있는 잡을 꼭 해보는 거를 권장을 하고 왜냐하면 일은 사람이 하는 거기 때문에 사람들과 같이 있는 상황에서 내가 내 파트너랑 내 동료랑 어떻게 일을 해서 내가 할 수 있는 것과 그들이 할 수 있는 것 그걸 같이 만들어내는 거는 우리나라든 전 세계 어디든 다 공통인 것 같고요. 그래서 그 을, 병, 정의 포지션에서 다른 사람을 이해할 수 있고 그 사람들이랑 같이 일할 수 있는 능력을 획득하려면 을, 병, 정의 포지션을 꼭 일을 해보는 걸 꼭 권장해 드립니다.
근데 을 병정을 했다가 평생 을 병정만 할까 봐 그게 좀 두려운 거죠.
그거는 네, 어렵겠네요.
그래도 일단 뭐든지 트라이를 해보고 경험을 해보는 게 되게 중요하다는 그런
중요한 건 이제 다 그 내 상대방에 필요한 거를 이해할 수 있는 능력을 키워라는 네. 거죠.
공감 능력 그게 가장 필요한 것 같습니다. 자, 긴 시간 동안 들어주셔서 감사드리고요. 예, 이 세 분한테 예, 큰 박수 부탁드립니다. 예. 지금 트로이는 바로 공항 가야 됩니다. 지금 시간이 없어서.